We are in the house, Steno Squad. Welcome to the Lady Steno Podcast, where I chat with the brightest real-time providers in the field of stenography. And if you are ready to increase your real-time speed and translation rate, head over to www.stenospeedclinic.com for an exciting opportunity. Now let's chat with today's featured guest, Jacqueline Love-Worline. Jacqueline, are you ready to go on the record?
I am so ready to go on the record, Lady Steno. This is going to be an exciting informational time for all of us.
It sure is. It sure is. Jacqueline just returned to freelance reporting last month. Prior to that, she was an official court reporter in Dallas County Probate Court for the last year. Jacqueline started providing real-time to attorneys since 2013 in cases involving expert witnesses in any industry you can think of. Now, Jackie, take a minute and fill in some blanks from that intro and give us some glimpse into your personal life.
Absolutely. First of all, thank you so much, Lady Steno, for the opportunity to speak with you today. I am formerly from Los Angeles, California. I'll always be a Cali girl at heart, even though I reside now in the Dallas-Fort Worth area. I am a, sort of a newlywed. My husband and I have been married for a little over a year now. We have a total of 6 kids combined, 4 of mine and 2 of his. Our girls are in college, and we have a son who is set to graduate high school this time next year. We are extremely active with our church. I sing in the choir. I also love to read. We love to travel together. I love photography, some interior design, and all things celebrity gossip. I actually graduated from Bryan College in Los Angeles. And at that time, when I started in 1983, we learned the Herman Miller theory. And we wrote everything out at that time. I started in 1983, went there for a couple of years, and I took a few years off to raise my family. I returned in 1991, and I graduated in 1992.
So how many years did you take off to raise your family, and what speed were you at?
I took about 6 or 7 years off, and when I stopped, I was only in 120 words per minute. That's as far as I had gotten. I got a little tempted. You know how it is. Life hits. I was a struggling student. And my current job, I was working at Montgomery Ward. I don't know if you all remember that store, but they were tempting me to come on full time, make a little more money. I needed a newer car. So I stopped and I started working full time. And I met my husband of my children and got married. And the rest was history. Then all of a sudden, I started dreaming about Steno, and I couldn't stop. Every other night, I was dreaming about Steno, and I took it as God's way of reminding me that, hey, this is where you're supposed to be. This is what you're supposed to be doing in life. Go ahead and pursue your passion. So I just closed my eyes and jumped, got back in Steno school, and graduated in no time at all. And I do not regret that decision at all.
And so once you got back, what speed were you at?
I was at 120. I tested in right at 120. It only took me about a year to get through it all completely. That to me was sort of a sign that, hey, this is a gift that God has given me. And it felt so natural to me, Lady Steno. I took a whole year to get back up, get my speed up to 225, took the California CSR exam, which in those days, it was the 2-day exam for voice at 200 words per minute. And I passed it. And I was just so ecstatic. I knew I had made the right decision. Now, everybody's story is not the same. There were young ladies and some young men who were in school, who had been in school the entire time. In fact, there was a young man who was still in school when I came back, which is perfectly fine. I know him today. He is a working court reporter. So everybody's story is different depending on your life's circumstances. Never compare yourself to anybody else.
It's definitely remarkable to get from 120 to 225 in 1 year. That's very impressive.
Thank you, Lady Steno.
And so then once you're done, you got your certification, you're in California. At what point did you decide to start providing real time?
I decided to start providing real time to attorneys because I realized what a value added service that is for us and our industry. It is important for us to keep up with technology. No matter what new technology comes out for our industry, I believe it's imperative for us to jump on that bandwagon and get as good at it as possible so we can always continue to make ourselves valuable to the legal profession. So once I decided that I was going to go ahead and share my screen, because that's all I really consider real timing to be, is just sharing my screen with the attorneys in the room. Once I decided to go ahead and do that, it really was an easy transition. Again, trying to work out the processes, how to set it up, how to introduce it to them, letting them know it's not a perfect science and you're really just viewing my rough draft. But at the end of the day, this will help you in your litigation. You're able to take notes, you're able to view live Q&A. And at the end of the day, I really believe that attorneys enjoy viewing real time.
What were the processes that you took to set up?
I decided that real timing was for me several years ago. And the steps that I decided to take included the following. First of all, I knew I needed good equipment. So I did my research again on Facebook. There are several real time groups. And I just read on a lot of different products that were available to real time. Specifically, the software I have, Case Catalyst, it's very compatible with live litigation, which is the software that I use for my real timing. There is a very small modem that hooks up to my laptop, and then there is a download, sort of an app that you go on, and it cuts the modem on, gives you a set of numbers. You then open up your iPad, download the same app, stick those numbers in the app, and voila, everything is connected. It's extremely easy. Once you practice 2-3 times, you'll find that it is such an easy process to get someone connected to your real time. There's also a way for you to actually click in a website on someone's laptop, and they can also view it and share your screen on their laptop. So you don't necessarily need iPads. You can also have those small netbooks. Besides researching the correct product for me, that worked for me, that I felt comfortable with, I also knew it was time for me to real time because I had heard so many stories about how lucrative it is. There is an additional rate that you can charge on top of your page rate, which enables you to make more money. So a lot of times you'll get assigned to an actual real time job. Then there are times when it's just a regular job. You know, as time goes on, you get a feel for what's a good job for you to upsell your real time. If it's heavy business litigation, contract disputes, construction defect, something probably where there's going to be an expert, those attorneys have more than likely been exposed to real time. They know what it is. They see the screen that's already set up in the middle of the table. And they naturally sort of gravitate towards it. So those are the types of jobs where you can actually make a little more money on, even though they're already good jobs to begin with because they're expert and they're technical. You can actually even increase your income by just having real time set up. So real time has worked great for me in that way to add extra money to my income. And again, it adds value to the legal profession for our industry. And it just gives us something additional in our skills toolbox to offer.
Absolutely. I use iPads for providing real time. And they're so light and the modem is so small that it makes sense to just bring an extra 2 or 3 iPads to any deposition that I go to, knowing that I could possibly upsell. And upselling with real time could even be doubling what you would make were real time not ordered. So it definitely is something that I have been doing and I highly recommend. So since we're on the money topic, what's the most lucrative assignment that you've had as a real timer?
Oh my goodness. I don't think I'll ever forget this job. It was my most lucrative to date. And it was actually when I first started real timing. So of course I was absolutely hooked, Lady Steno. After that, I began to make sure I had my iPads and my modem, and I carry them in a separate bag, but I keep it with me constantly. So let me tell you a little bit about the job. It was a construction defect job. It was way out in the country at this beautiful construction office. I knew it was going to be an 0-7. So you know, I was already hyped up to go. I said, you know what? They didn't order real time. I'll bring my stuff anyway. I brought my equipment. I got it all set up. And sure enough, every single person grabbed a screen. So I said, okay, this is going to be a good day. All told, at the end of the day, it was a 3-day construction defect job with plenty of experts and a lot of hard work. Let me tell you, this money was not easily earned. It was a lot of hard work, and my check was a little over
$12,000. $12,000. If it wasn't real time, what do you estimate you would have made?
I probably would have made somewhere between 8 and 9. So it was going to be a lucrative job anyway because of the multiple copies and the content was very technical. So I stood to make a decent amount of money without. But if you can increase your income that way, I say go for it.
I mean, absolutely. If you didn't have your iPads that day, you would have made $8,000 or $9,000 for that deposition. But you increased your income by $3,000, $4,000 simply by having your iPads there. It's not like your writing was any different. You write the same the way you always write, but you just shared your screen.
Just sharing your screen, Lady Steno, makes a lot of difference. And if anyone is concerned about the cost to get started with real time, I found used iPads on eBay for little to no money. The modem costs about $300 a year. But I have to tell you, with the extra money that I made that day, I paid for all of that 2-3 times over.
Yes, Steno Squad. Like Jackie said, there is a cost to getting started in providing real time. Just like there was a cost in getting started and becoming a professional court reporter. These costs are a necessary investment in our advancement. It is this investment that earns us the ability to bring more value to the marketplace and therefore get paid more. See, the truth of the matter is, we all sit in a chair and write on our little Stenotype machine. The only thing Jackie did differently to increase her income by almost $4,000 in just 3 days was offer the value of real time. This actually reminds me of a quote by Jim Rohn. He said, "You don't get paid by the hour. You get paid for the value you bring to the hour." Steno Squad, Jackie and I will be right back. But first, let's take a minute to thank our sponsor. Have you ever thought, hey, if I could just write faster and cleaner, this job would be so much easier? If so, it's time to check out the Lady Steno Speed Clinic. The Lady Steno Speed Clinic is a 3-day in-person workshop that will absolutely transform your writing and boost your skill set to skyrocket your career and income. Imagine, within a few weeks of attending the Lady Steno Speed Clinic, your writing will require less scoping, you'll gain massive amounts of confidence, and increase your value in our industry. You will learn over 3,000 everyday phrases so that you can be one of the shortest writers in the country. Application of these phrases in your writing will lead to clean real time, even at high speeds. That alone can give you the upper hand in the entire industry. Visit www.stenospeedclinic.com and register today. Once again, www.stenospeedclinic.com. And we are back, Steno Squad, with Jacqueline Love-Worline. Now, Jackie,
Before the break, we were talking about a lot of great stuff that has happened to you in your Steno life, but I'm sure there's been at least one moment that you can call your worst moment while real timing. Take us to that moment. Give us the details on what happened.
If I can recall back correctly, it's probably again when I first started and none of my equipment would act right. At the end of the day, it turned out to be user error. It was completely my error. I did not realize at the time that I had support that was associated with my equipment. So of course I'm fiddling, trying to figure out what am I doing wrong? I'm not plugging this in the right place. Why is it not coming up? And it was about 30 minutes before the deposition started. Everyone was slowly arriving. So of course I'm starting to get extremely nervous at this point. I made myself calm down, take a breath and breathe. It occurred to me, wait a minute. I know there's got to be someone that I can call. So I flipped the modem over and sure enough, there was the number to support. I called support. They gave me everything I needed to get up and running in less than 10 minutes. And my takeaway from that is during the time that they were speaking to me, I wrote everything down that they said. Now, keep in mind, I have had those same kinks before. I have had them again. But this time, I was smart enough to save those tips and tricks in a folder. That folder has saved me so many times. I have things in there like the federal read-in that we reporters must do if there is not a videographer present or the videographer doesn't want to do it. I have the oath in there in case I just have one of those moments where I have a brain fart and I cannot remember how to swear in a witness. I have tons of little tips and tricks in that folder, including how to troubleshoot my real-time equipment. And it takes me 2 minutes to look at that folder. Oh yeah, that's right. I have to go here and here and here. And sure enough, once I apply those tips and tricks, my real-time equipment starts working perfectly. So that particular day I was having a problem. Again, everyone was gathering. No one actually saw the problem I was having, but my nightmare was that someone would. And if I hadn't called support that day, we would have had a real big problem because they specifically ordered real time. But it's really important that you come prepared to a real time deposition. Make sure your equipment is working at night. Call your support. Ask them, do you have any tricks for me? Do you have any tips for me? You know, is there anything that I can anticipate happening in the future that could go wrong? So preparation is the key to successful real time.
And speaking of preparation, other than making sure the equipment is working the night before, what else do you do to prepare for real-time jobs?
If at all possible, if the firm has a prior ETRAN, if there was prior depositions in the case, that's always helpful to get, as well as if there are any notices, if there's a word index in the back of the ETRAN, make sure you go and take a look at everything unfamiliar to you and try to get those into your dictionary and define them as much as you can. Go through the notice, put in all of the attorney's names. If it's a subpoena, deuces take them, which a lot of times will have some good information, the information that they have requested from the witness. Go through all of that because there are things that they will say and you'll be like, what? But a lot of times it's on the subpoena, deuces take them. If you just go through it, the last few pages will list things like, please provide information regarding Harry Jones's affiliation with XYZ company in Nebraska. And you're like, okay, Nebraska is not in my dictionary. That company name's not in my dictionary. You will be surprised how smoothly your day will go if you just take 30 minutes to 45 minutes and sit down and go through whatever paperwork you have. And let's say you don't have any paperwork. Let's say the firm has not been provided anything. There's been no prior depositions. Well, if you can get the content of the job, go in and Google some terms that may come up. For instance, if it's a forensic psychologist, Google forensic psychology and just see what words you can pop into your dictionary. If you have no idea what the content is, at least see if you can get the style. You should be provided with at least the style. Go into those company websites and click on their About Us and plug in all of the names of the executives. Do something to try to prepare for what you may possibly hear the next day.
And what about your writing style? Outside of preparing for a real-time job, do you brief a lot? Do you write everything out now? I know you were taught to write everything out, but what would you say your writing style is like now?
We were definitely taught to write everything out, Lady Steno. When I first started, we dictated into a machine at night. So my writing style has evolved quite a lot. I figured out it was sort of an epiphany. I can almost remember the day when it occurred to me that, hey, wait a minute. I know I was trained to do things a certain way, but this is not working for me in real life. And that's the difference between school and real life. You will find yourself tweaking your writing style to fit your everyday working life to make it as easy as possible. My motto is work smarter, not harder. So that phrase that I wrote out in school and that we were trained to write all the way out in school, 9 times out of 10, I definitely do not write like that anymore. A common phrase that comes up as you sit here today, as we sit here today, as I sit here today, I have an amazing phrase for that. And it's just one stroke. And so I have to say that now, all these years of reporting, I'm probably about 50-50. Maybe 60-40. I do write a lot of things out. And again, along with writing things out, your speed has to be at a certain level as well. You have to maintain your speed in order to write things out. Briefing is easier, but you do whatever does not make you hesitate. Whatever keeps you from hesitating is what you do.
Hesitation is the enemy.
It certainly is. Hesitation can cost you seconds. So it's also important to work on your retention and your listening skills. You have to be able to keep things in your head for several seconds. And your average, normal, everyday person thinks that's easy. That is so not easy to retain what someone is saying while they're still talking.
That's definitely one of our superhero qualities.
Yes, it is.
What is the best court reporting advice you have ever received?
The best court reporting advice I've ever received is to not only be excellent at what you do on the machine, but be as business savvy as you possibly can when it comes to this industry. If you're a freelance reporter, I cannot stress that enough. There are so many things that you need to know to be business savvy as a freelance independent reporter. Get a mentor so you can learn this business inside and out. And make sure when you get a mentor, to make sure you get a mentor who is willing to be extremely transparent and open with you about what rates you should be charging at your level. Always give firms your rates. Always. Send them your rates. Learn how to create a rate sheet and what goes on it. That was excellent advice. Stay organized. Someone told me that paperwork organization, file organization is extremely important when it comes to this business. And I had to learn that the hard way my first year out as a freelancer because my paperwork was everywhere. And when it came time for taxes, it was a complete nightmare. I almost had to recreate everything. I had to find all my receipts. So, you know, just making sure your paperwork is organized so you can get your hands on it when it comes time. And also another good piece of advice, Lady Steno, was to put everything that I owe for taxes, put it in a separate account and also back up my files. I keep a separate hard drive and I back up all of my files onto that hard drive. There are some reporters that even actually place their file on a thumb drive before they even leave the job, just to make sure it's in two places, because nightmares have been known to happen. You get the blue screen of death on your laptop and everything is gone.
That was a lot of great advice you just gave us. Thank you so much. And what about for the future real timers out there? Maybe a student who's still in 180 or 120, or maybe a court reporter who's been working for 5 or 6 years. What advice would you give them so that they can start providing real time within the next year or two or three?
A clean dictionary is imperative to being an excellent real time writer. That's the point of real time, right? You want a layperson, someone who's not familiar with Steno, doesn't know what we really do, you want them to be able to read your screen. You want it to come out in translated English. That's the point of real time. Build up your dictionary all the time. Any untranslate you see at the end of the day, or at the end of your study day, at the end of your work day, go back in and add those words, those untrans, to your dictionary. Also, get good phrases. Phrasing will save you on a very difficult and bad writing day, because we all have bad writing days. We could be tired. The witness could slur or have an accent that you just really are having a difficult time discerning what they're saying. Phrasing will save you so much energy at the end of the day. And just prep as much as you possibly can the day before the job, and you will find that you will thank yourself for spending those extra few minutes to get prepared.
Well, thank you so much, Jackie. This has been an amazing episode. You have given us so many tips, so much inspiration, and I am honored that you are the first guest of the Lady Steno podcast.
I'm honored as well, Lady Steno. I hope I was able to provide some valuable information to your listeners. I wish you much success in your future endeavors here on your podcast.